Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cunningham's Encyclopedia of Crystal, Gem, and Metal Magic by Scott Cunningham. Narrated by Paul Boehmer. Publisher's Note: This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Cunningham's Encyclopedia of Crystal, Gem, and Metal Magic into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code STONE, and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. The tables, resources, and glossary referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Introduction. Crystals, stones, metals. Amethyst for peace, quartz for power, silver for psychism. From the earliest prehistoric times to our technological age, we have found beauty, power, and mystery within stones. Just as herbs possess energies, so too do stones and metals. With their powers, we can change ourselves and our lives. Stone magic is as old as time. It began when the earliest humans sensed some force or power trapped within the stones that surrounded them. Stones were probably first used as amulets, objects worn to deflect negativity or evil. Later, they were revered as deities, offered as sacrifices, and buried for blessings and fertility of the land. Their use is intimately connected with religion, ritual, and magic. Stone magic has been forgotten by many millions of people today. The Industrial Revolution and two devastating wars destroyed the insular village life in which the old magic was passed from generation to generation. Today, a new awareness of the magical value of stones and metals has swept over us. This sudden interest is truly unprecedented in history and, like the growing use of herbs in magic, is another manifestation of people finding their microchip lives unsatisfying. Something, magic, is missing. In my 16-year journey into the world of shamanism and magic, I've become convinced that at one time or another, every aspect of human existence was governed by magic. Over the centuries, we've lost most of this wisdom, but tantalizing fragments remain. Persons with no interest in magic may think that wearing birthstones is lucky, that pearls are said to bring a bride tears, and that the hope diamond is cursed. They may not know why they think such things, but they do. If we look into the past, to an age where the mystic properties of stones and metals were unquestioned, we find answers. Stones, like colors, plants, and other natural objects, are magical tools that we can use to cause needed change. Transformation is the essence of magic, and stones help us achieve this by lending their powers and providing focal points for our own energies. After centuries of repressive religious structures and deadening materialism, many of us are awakening to the fact that we have become estranged from the earth. Executives toss brilliantly hued gems onto black velvet, studying their patterns for hints of the future. Secretaries place moonstone and azurite between their brows to strengthen psychic awareness. Students wear quartz crystal to improve their study habits. The old ways are once again accessible to all who desire to use them. Stones and metals are keys that we can use to unlock our potential as human beings. They expand our consciousness, enhance our lives, calm our stresses, and infuse our dreams with healing energies. Skeptics say it's our minds. Magicians say, yes, that's part of it. It's also in the stones, in our ritual use of these treasures, and in our connections with the earth. Stone magic works. It is effective. That's all anyone needs to know to try it out. In using stone magic, we don't turn our backs on technology. I'm not giving up electricity and other benefits of our age. No. We use this old magic to improve our hectic lives, to give us deeper understanding and control over them. It attunes us with the powers that created stones, ourselves, the earth, and the universe, thereby adding the missing ingredient to our often sterile lives. When a stone, lying in a dry riverbed, calls you to pick it up, when a shimmering crystal seems to pull your hand, when a faceted jewel set in a ring captures your imagination, you've felt the old powers of stones. The stones, the magic, are waiting. The rest is up to you. Part 1. Beginnings and Magic. Chapter 1. The Powers of Stones. Moonlight. A woman stands in her garden. The wind lifts her white scarf into the air as the silver light rains down upon her. In her upraised hands lie a six-sided crystal. She gazes at the shimmering stone, sensing its erratic, disturbing vibrations. As the breeze dies, it silences a stand of ancient pines that encircle the figure. The moon seems to glow brighter, and the woman feels its soothing light radiating down from the sky. The stone calms. Its bizarre vibrations diminish and then grow strong, uniting to form a single, regular pulsation of energy. As the woman holds the stone higher, its power spills down into her arms, flowing through her like a series of pleasant electric shocks. She grows vibrant and powerful. After an immeasurable time, the figure lowers the stone and impulsively touches it to her brow. Her work is done. The crystal is purified and ready for magic. Stones may lie deep within the earth or exposed to the sun and stars. They are dull or prismatic, dense or coarse, blue, green, red, and colors no rainbow dares to display are common among them. Plentiful agate and costly emerald, transparent tricolored tourmalines, and opaque marble, royal purple sugilite and clear quartz crystal. Stones are gifts of the earth. They are manifestations of the universal forces of deity, goddess, god, and fate, which created all that is, all that was, and all that has potential of being. The earth is one tiny part of a vast energy network. Though once created by it, our planet now contains its own vibrations. Some of these powers and their manifestations are shaded and formed to benefit us. Stones are magical batteries that contain and concentrate the earth's energies. Many are thought to also be affected by, or at least symbolic of, the planets and luminaries of our solar system. Others have long been associated with far distant stars. Magic and stones are anciently related. Rocks, shaped into animal forms by wind and rain, have been used as symbols and as the focus of rites for longer than has been recorded. For 10,000 years, shimmering gemstones have been carried or worn for protection against the unknown. Stones that were scarce, strangely shaped, or that exhibited electrical or magnetic properties are long-time magical tools. In the earliest ages, stones were carved into images that seemed to be religious or magical in nature. They also provided building materials. Tools fashioned from them cut grain, shaped garments, extracted thorns, and performed surgery. Stone weapons guarded and ended life. Rocks were heated to boil water eons before the invention of fireproof vessels. Stones were at once beautiful and utilitarian, sacred and profane. Through the ages, humans have relied on stones to ensure conception, ease childbirth, guard personal safety and health, and to protect the dead. More recently, stones have been used in magic for internal or external change. Moonstones are worn to promote psychic awareness. Amethyst calms tempers. Peridot is carried to attract wealth. Rose quartz draws love. Today, 5,000 years of stone magic is at our fingertips. Many people are discovering the powers within stones. Working with rocks, these people, stone, natural magicians, are transforming their lives. What is stone magic anyway? How can a few rocks scratched out of the dirt have any effect on anything? Stones, like herbs, colors, metals, numbers, and sounds, are not inert. They may sit quietly in the earth for millions of years or rest on a shelf where we placed them last week, but they are active, powerful tools possessing energies that can and do affect our world. Stones are gifts from the earth that we can use to improve our lives, our relationships, and ourselves. Many are readily available and inexpensive, while others can be gently collected from the ground itself. Stone magic is built upon simple ideas and has direct results. Using a stone in magic brings its influences and energies into play. Directing those energies is the magic. If you have decided to attune and work with stones, welcome to the world of crystalline magic. You might never leave it. What secrets lie within the water-worn pebble lying on the beach? What hidden energies pulse inside the stone on your finger, the gems around your neck? Could the very rocks you walk upon draw a love into your life or help you financially? Find the answers for yourself. The powers within stones are available to all. Use the earth's treasures wisely, and they will bless you with all that you truly need. Chapter 2. Magic. Magic is transformation. Transformation is magic. All magic is change. All change is magic. Stones, crystals, and metals, as well as colors, scents, forms, movement, earth, air, water, fire, insects, animals, ourselves, our planet, and our universe contain energy. It is this energy that permits us to practice magic. In the philosophy of the magician, the wise woman, the shaman, the kahuna, and the high priestess, this energy descends from the primal, original source. This has been termed goddess, god, supreme deity, fate, and many other names. Countless faiths have created complex ritual calendars and stories concerning this energy. It is that which is revered within all religions. But this energy source is actually beyond religion, beyond theory or explanation. It simply is, everywhere, within ourselves and our planet. Magical practitioners are those who have learned of this energy. They arouse, release, and direct energy. Contrary to what you may have heard, magic is a natural process. It is not the stuff of demons and unsavory creatures, and no fallen archangel lends us the ability to practice magic. These are the ideas of a religious philosophy that abhors individualism. Magic is, in a sense, true individualism, for it allows us as individuals to take control of our lives and work to improve them. Is magic supernatural? No, the supernatural doesn't exist. Think about it for a moment. Super meaning extra, outside of, differing from, and natural. Outside of nature? Different from nature? No way. Magic is as natural as stone, as real as our breath, as potent as the sun. Stone magic, the use of the energies within stones to effect needed changes, is a perfect example of the naturalness of magic, for what could be more organic than rocks? Most books written on crystals and stones today are primarily concerned with spiritual development and healing. Few of these works deal with any other aspects of magic. That's where this book is different. It contains magic, developing psychic awareness, drawing love and friendship, releasing sexual dysfunction, attracting money and health, sharpening mental powers, inducing peace and happiness. These are the wonders that can be created through the powers of stones. Magic isn't worked by controlling or dominating nature. Again, this is a non-magician's view, another holdover from the magic is supernatural idea. In magic, we work in harmony with these forces. Magic practiced any other way is limiting and is often merely a strong ego boost for the magician. This chapter discusses some basics of magic in order to make part two of this book usable, where visualization or directing the power or setting up a stone altar is called for. You'll know the basics. But again, as I stress in all my books, I, naturally, write about what has worked for me and what feels comfortable. If my rites and symbols and mental processes don't speak to you, investigate and find the ones that do. Remember, nature is the teacher. Nature is a phenomenon of magic. It is an illustration in the Universal Spellbook. If these written words mean little to you, listen to the stones, to the wind, to fire and water. Listen and learn. Three necessities. As I first outlined in Earth Power, there are three things that must exist for successful magic. These are the need. A need must exist. Usually, this is a need that can't be satisfied through other means. Attracting love, guarding your home, obtaining housing, or other material objects are prime examples. A need is an empty space in your life or a critical condition, such as ill health or danger, that must be worked on immediately. Magic fills that vacuum or corrects the condition, thereby fulfilling the need. The emotion. Along with the need, there must be emotion. Emotion is power. Seeing red is an example of this. The face grows hot, the heartbeat increases. These are manifestations of power. If you aren't emotionally involved in your need, you will be unable to raise sufficient power from any source and direct it to your need. In other words, your magic won't work. If you need to pass an upcoming exam, for example, but you don't really want to, any magic done to improve your chances will fail. The emotion sets the power free to bring the need into actual manifestation. The knowledge. This is the way of magic. The techniques that we use to arouse energy within ourselves or natural objects, such as stones, and send it forth toward the magical need. The knowledge includes visualization, basics of ritual, concentration, and the reality of power. This chapter contains some beginnings of the knowledge. If we have the need and the emotion, but not the knowledge of how to use these things, we would be like a Neanderthal human contemplating a can opener or a computer. We wouldn't know how to use the tools. Once the need, the emotion, and the knowledge are present, we can begin to practice magic. Magical morality. We practice magic to improve our lives and those of our friends and loved ones. Magic is performed out of love, not hate. It is harmony with nature, not domination. Many people become interested in magic because they think it's a great way to get rid of their enemies. They see magic as a weapon of anger rather than a tool of love. Power is neutral. Electricity, one manifestation of the power, can be used during laser surgery to save life or to energize an electric chair to end it. Energy is the same. Our intentions and needs determine its effects on the outside world. Magic isn't, or shouldn't be, an instrument of selfishness, domination, pain, fear, manipulation, ego gratification, or control. On the contrary, it is life-affirming, infused with love, joy, contentment, pleasure, and growth. As I've said, if I was ever truly hateful of someone, which has never happened, I'd probably throw a punch their way rather than a spell. Some people disagree with me on this point and have said so to my face in classes and workshops. I just shake my head, for there's no talking to folks like that. Soon they drop out of sight and are never heard from again. If you stick your finger into a hot light socket, you get shocked. Practice manipulative magic, you get worse. The choice, quite simply, is yours. You or them. It's best to work magic to cause changes within yourself or your life before helping others. In this way, you'll quickly learn how it works and how best to perform it. This isn't selfishness. Your life is your magical laboratory. Once the experiments have worked, you can apply them to others. Who would trust a magician whose life is in disarray, who is in debt, constantly sick, or emotionally unstable? Visualization. You can practice visualization. Close your eyes and see your best friend's face, or your favorite piece of clothing. Understand? Visualization is simply seeing without the eyes. Magical or creative visualization is forming similar pictures of your magical need. In other words, we see what has yet to be. In a sense, this visualization is the key that moves the energy toward the goal. Forming and perfecting magical visualizations is easy with practice. If you wish to bring a love into your life, hold a rose quartz and visualize yourself as being involved in that relationship. Even though you can't see the person's face, remember, magic is not manipulative. See yourself happily with that person. Let the emotion of your need, as well as your need itself, wrap you in its warm embrace. Then, see the energy from within you streaming into the stone and then out to do its work. That's magical visualization. Charging stones. Before using them in magic, stones should be charged or programmed with energy. This is done simply by holding the stone in your projective hand, usually the right, but the left for lefties, visualizing your magical need and pouring energy out from your body into the stone. This energy is personal power. It resides within all of us. We can move this energy from our bodies out into stones, candles, metals, and other objects to help us achieve our magical goals. The movement of this or other forms of natural energy is at the heart of magic. See the power flowing out from your body through your projective hand and into the stone. Charge it with the energy of your magical need, love, money, power, health. When you know that the stone is vibrating with your personal power, the charging is complete. This simple process performed before each ritual will greatly enhance the effects of your stone magic. The stone altar. If you wish, perform your magic, at least that which is done indoors, at a stone altar. This isn't a place where we worship rocks, of course, but an area set aside for the practice of magic. Ideally, fashion an altar by placing a large slab of marble or some other stone on a flat-topped tree trunk, a dresser, bureau, or coffee table. This action forms the altar itself where you will work with the tools of stone magic. Otherwise, any table will suffice. Magical objects are often placed on the stone altar. These may be good luck charms, or power stones and metals such as large quartz crystals, cross stones, staurolites, lodestones, fossils, lava, and opals. This is the place to cleanse and purify stones, to attune with them and perform magic. Many of the spells mentioned in this book involve the use of candles as well as stones, and it is on the stone altar that these are placed and burned. Incense, flowers, and any other magical objects can be added to the stone altar as long as they are in tune with your magical need, or if you consider them to be power objects. Those things that increase or improve your ability to raise and send forth energy. The stone altar is a place of magic. Chapter 3. Stone Energies. A bewildering array of stones awaits our use in magic. They come in endless forms, crystalline shapes, and colors. Their uses in magic are incredibly varied. As I mentioned in Chapter 1, stones are storehouses of energies. We use these energies in magic to bring about needed change. There are two basic types of energy within stones. These two types contain all the various vibrations found in stones. Those that attract love, repel negativity, and so on. These are the projective and the receptive energies. They are manifestations of the purest forms of the universal energies that created everything. They have many symbols. In religion, they are known as God and Goddess. In astronomy, the sun and the moon. In humans, male and female. Here are some more associations. Projective, electric. Receptive, magnetic. Projective, hot. Receptive, cold. Projective, day. Receptive, night. Projective, physical. Receptive, spiritual. Projective, bright. Receptive, dark. Projective, summer. Receptive, winter. Projective, knife. Receptive, cup. Projective, active. Receptive, inert. These powers are everywhere within the universe. They are present in our planet and ourselves. In magical thought, they lie within our bodies. Symbolically speaking, this is why we can reproduce young of either sex and practice all forms of magic. We contain both projective and receptive energies. These forces have nothing to do with our physical sex, or rather, they shouldn't. But since we are trained from birth to stress that energy that conforms to our physical sex, imbalances are quite common. Boys are dressed in blue, taught to play baseball, wear pants, and so on. Though this is changing today, it is still the norm. One of the goals of the magician is to attain a perfect balance of these twin forces. When they become unbalanced, when one energy is more abundant or stressed, the magician follows suit. An overabundance of projective energy makes the magician irritable, aggressive, angry, and overly analytical. Health-wise, this imbalance may lead to ulcers, headaches, high blood pressure, and other maladies. Too much receptive energy creates moodiness, lethargy, depression, disinterest, and a shutting out of the physical world. Other possible problems are nightmares, clinging love, lack of employment, depressed immunoresponse, and hypochondria. When and if you notice an imbalance in your energy makeup, carry or wear stones of the opposite type to bring that force into play. That gets us back to stones. The projective stones are those that are bright, outward, aggressive, and electrical. They possess strong, forceful energies that deflect evil, overcome inertia, and create movement. Projective stones help destroy disease, strengthen the conscious mind, and imbue their wearer with courage and determination. They are used to promote physical energy, attract luck, and bring success. In magic, they might be used to add additional strength to rituals. These rocks and minerals are used in two basic ways: to drive off unwanted negative energies, or to put energies into an object or person. A woman wearing a carnelian for courage, for example, brings its energies into herself. The same woman wishing to deflect negativity from her body would empower the stone through visualization for this purpose. Thus, instead of sending energy into her, the stone sends it away from her. The secret, obviously, is in the visualization. Projective stones contact the conscious mind. They are often heavy or dense, occasionally opaque, and are red, orange, yellow, gold, or clear. They may also shine or gleam like the sun. Examples of projective stones and minerals include ruby, diamond, lava, topaz, and rhodochrosite. Projective stones are associated with the sun, Mercury, Mars, Uranus, and the elements of fire and air. They are also related to the stars, since stars are simply distant suns. Receptive stones are the natural complement of projective stones. They are soothing, calming, inward, and magnetic, promoting meditation, spirituality, wisdom, and mysticism. They create peace. These stones promote communication between the conscious and subconscious minds, allowing psychic awareness to blossom. They radiate energies that attract love, money, healing, and friendship. Receptive stones are often used for grounding purposes to stabilize and reaffirm our earth roots. Like projective stones, the receptive ones are also used in two basic ways. Lapis lazuli can be used to draw love or, with different empowering, to absorb depression and thus create joy. Receptive stones are found in a wide range of colors: green, blue, blue-green, purple, gray, silver, pink, black, the absence of color, and white, all colors combined. They may also be opalescent or translucent and be naturally pierced with a hole. Examples of receptive stones include moonstone, aquamarine, emerald, holy stones, rose quartz, pink tourmaline, kunzite, lapis lazuli, and sugilite. They are linked with the moon, Venus, Saturn, Neptune, Jupiter, and the elements of earth and water. Not all stones fit easily into one of these categories, but this is a good system to help us relate the stones to their basic powers. Some stones contain a mixture of these energies, like lapis lazuli. Others may have uses that belie this simple classification, so use your judgment in determining their basic powers. Remember, this is a system to be used for our benefit. It cannot be correct 100% of the time. Just by looking at some unknown stone, by noticing its weight and color, you'll be able to know something about its magical properties even before trying to sense them. The next time you see a stone, anywhere, try to determine whether it is receptive or projective. If this becomes an automatic process, you'll quickly learn the stones themselves and, in doing so, will discover stone magic becoming easier to practice. Chapter 4. The Rainbow of Power. As I mentioned in the previous chapter, the colors of stones are a vital clue to unlocking their magical uses. Colors are energies with direct effects on our minds. As an example of this, many prisons now paint prisoner-holding areas a light pink hue. When aggressive criminals are placed in these rooms, they become calm. Why? Pink is a soothing, loving color. The convicts, unless they're under the influence of mood-altering drugs, simply can't remain violent in such an environment. Similarly, many hospitals are now painting surgery and recuperation rooms blue. This color has long been used in magic to promote healing, and now orthodox medicine is finally catching on and using it too. The old magical systems are starting to be understood as we become more aware of the effects of color. If pink walls calm angry persons, why shouldn't stones of the same color be useful for attracting love? Even on this superficial level, the colors that stones exhibit can have dramatic effects. When we use color as a key to other, less physical effects of stones, the realm of magic is truly entered. The purpose of this section is to examine the basic colors of stones, as well as their magical properties. Just as with Chapter 3, this information can act as a guide in discovering your own uses for stones, as well as in understanding the information presented in Part 2 of this book. This might be a good place to add some notes concerning magical healing. No one can heal another's body. Certainly, there are techniques that facilitate this, but the healing must come from within. Most healers say that all they can do is speed up the healing process, perhaps by removing blockages in the energy flow through the sick person's body. Stones have been used in healing magic for centuries, and some must have been effective. By presenting this traditional information in part two of this book, I'm not telling you to grab a bloodstone when you cut your finger or an emerald if you have eye troubles. I'm simply suggesting that such measures can be used in conjunction with orthodox medical treatment. So, grab a bandage and antibacterial cream, or a plantain leaf, and dress the wound. Then, use a bloodstone to help speed your recovery. Magic isn't a slap in the face of technology. It can and should be used with it whenever possible. Listening to the healing information in this book with this in mind should clear up any questions regarding this aspect of stone magic. No doubt, stones are powerful. But we must be knowledgeable about them, in harmony with them, and in touch with our own bodies for this magic to be effective. Anyway, colors are powers. Colored stones are doubly powerful. Here are some of these energies. Red. Red is the color of blood, of birth, and death. In many cultures, it has been sacred or dedicated to the deities. Red stones are projective, active. They are related to the planet Mars and the element of fire, both aggressive energies. These are protective stones and work to strengthen the body and willpower. Red stones are used to promote courage, to lend energy to the body, and to provide additional power to rituals by their presence on the altar. In ancient times, red stones were worn as antidotes to poison, to keep one's thoughts pure, and, by drawing out the causes, to banish anger and all violent emotions. They were also used as a guard against fire and lightning. In healing, red stones are intimately linked with blood. They are often worn to relieve anemia, to halt bleeding, and to heal wounds. They also seem to work on rashes and inflammation. Perhaps in association with its blood links, red stones were once carried to prevent miscarriage. Red stones can be empowered and used to overcome sexual dysfunctions, usually by placing the stone near or on the genitals while visualizing. Pink. Pink stones are receptive, packed with loving vibrations. They are calming, soothing, and are used to de-stress and relax the physical body as well as the mind. Sometimes thought to be ruled by Venus, though green is a more Venusian color, pink stones are used to attract a love or to strengthen love already present. They may work to smooth over difficulties in long-standing relationships. They can be worn to promote self-love. This isn't narcissism, but a realization of your faults, acceptance, and release of them, and then getting on with life. As I and many others before me have said, we cannot expect others to love us if we don't love ourselves. Pink stones are one energy we can use to achieve this. Pink stones promote peace, happiness, joy, and laughter. They stimulate the lighter emotions, help attract friends, and encourage openness toward others. They are ideal to utilize in group rituals. Orange. Orange stones have some of the fire of red, but are gentler in their effects. Projective, they have often been seen as symbols of the sun, They are ideal for use in protective rituals and those designed to promote illumination. These stones are related to personal power. Wearing one will enhance your ability to tap into and direct this energy during magical rites. These are excellent stones to wear for those people with low self-esteem, for they expand your awareness of self-worth. Orange stones are also thought to be luck-attracting, and as symbols of success, they are worn during spells to assure positive outcome. Yellow. Yellow stones and minerals are projective. Ruled by Mercury, they are used in rituals involving communication. If you're having trouble expressing yourself in an intelligible way, try wearing a yellow stone. Writers may receive help with their work by utilizing yellow stones, while public speakers wear them for eloquence. Also ruled by the Sun, yellow stones are protective, while the element of air, also a ruler, tells us that they can be used to strengthen the conscious mind. They are worn during magic to heighten visualization abilities. Spells involving travel can be performed with yellow stones, perhaps by holding one in your projective hand and visualizing yourself traveling to your desired location. Health-wise, yellow stones are used to promote digestion, to regulate the nervous system, and for skin problems. These are stones of movement, of exchange, of energy, and mental awareness. Green, the color of nature, of fertility, of life, green has often been linked with red in religion and magic. Stones of this hue are receptive. They are used in healing magic, perhaps by surrounding a green or blue candle with the gems, lighting the candle, and then visualizing the sick person as a vibrant, totally healed person. They can also be carried or worn to guard the health. Specifically, green stones are thought to strengthen the eyes, control the kidneys, relieve stomach problems, and prevent migraines. Ruled by Venus, green stones are worn during gardening to promote luxuriant growth, or are placed in the earth for this purpose. If you have houseplants, try putting a few empowered green stones in the earth. Due to such usage, they were also thought to increase fertility and, therefore, to promote conception. Their associations with the element of earth also lead to their use in spells involving money, riches, prosperity, and luck. They are grounding and balancing stones that can be worn to attune with the earth. Blue. Blue is the color of the ocean, of sleep, and of twilight. Ruled by the element of water and the planet Neptune, these are receptive stones and promote peace. Holding a blue stone or gazing at it by a soft light calms the emotions. If you have difficulty sleeping, try wearing blue stones to bed. This is also excellent for halting nightmares. Blue stones are worn or used to promote healing in general and specifically to reduce fevers, remove ulcers and their causes, and for eliminating inflammations. They are sometimes held to reduce or remove pain from the body. If you feel in need of a purification, wear blue stones, perhaps while bathing, to purify your inner being as well as your outer flesh. This is often done prior to magical ritual. Purple. Stones that are purple or indigo colored are receptive and spiritual. Ruled by Jupiter and Neptune, they have long been associated with mysticism and purification. These are excellent stones to wear for meditation, psychic work, or during any ritual designed to contact the subconscious mind. As with green and blue stones, purple is the color of healing and peace. These stones are worn to maintain health and are sometimes given to unruly children to promote obedience. Physically, purple stones are utilized to relieve complaints in the head, such as headache, mental illness, concussion, and hair problems. They relieve depression and produce restful sleep when worn at night. Purple stones are associated with organized religion as well as the more spontaneous, earth-oriented systems. They are worn to contact higher forces. White. White stones are receptive and ruled by the moon. As such, they are intimately linked with sleep and psychism. In the past, white stones, especially chalcedony, were worn to promote lactation by mothers having trouble feeding their babies. In contemporary America, these are considered to be lucky stones, often carried in the pocket or worn to promote good fortune. Because the moon glows at night, her stones are used for protection.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.